Hello everyone, my name is Dina Atta. I'm working as a petroleum engineer at Khalda Petroleum Company. I will be your moderator today for this session. I want to welcome all of you and engineer Mohammed Al-Gabri. He will be our presenter today. Let me introduce him to you. Engineer Mohammed Al-Gabri is a senior petroleum engineer with 9 years of working experience with Khalda Apache in Egypt. Engineer Mohammed has a bachelor degree in petroleum engineering from Saudi University. Mohammed is working with hydraulic fracturing team at Khalda Apache Joint Venture. Mohammed's experience is hydraulic fracturing for conventional and unconventional reservoirs and as a stimulation for vertical and horizontal wells from design, execution in the field, and evaluation. Mohammed published multiple papers with SPE, OTC, and Aroma. We have an amazing session today, and I hope all you to enjoy the session. And Engineer Mohammed, the floor is yours.
Thanks, Engineer Dina. Thank you, Dr. Rengarhi. Today, our lecture about hydraulic fracturing design using simulators. Our outlines today will talk about, will start review about hydraulic fracturing was Dr. Rengarhi and Engineer Youssef Al-Waziri. And we'll talk about a very important concept called net pressure. And we'll talk about the fracture propagation concepts, and we'll go through general hydraulic fracture design, and we'll take example for that workflows from FragBrew and Gopher. First of all, what is hydraulic fracturing? Hydraulic fracturing, as mentioned before, is to inject fluid above the fracture above the fracture pressure to create a fracture. This fracture provides a conductive bath for reservoir flow for the reservoir fluid to increase the productivity of the well. So, if we took a plain view for a well, there is a damage zone around well bore, and we conduct hydraulic fracture and fill this fracture with propant. We provide a solution for the reservoir by a conductive bath to enhance the productivity for this well. So one of essential parameters which needed to be kept in mind is dimensionless fracture conductivity. Dimensionless fracture conductivity is the fracture conductivity of this fracture, which is a width multiplied by the permeability of this fracture, divided by formation deliverability, which is the formation permeability multiplied by the fracture half length. So generally, there is no frag as absolute, is a good frag as an absolute value and bad frag. It's depend on your reservoir. How can we conduct this hydraulic fracturing? By starting bombing bed, which is fluid without any probant, then start ramping probant to fill this fracture with probant with different concentrations, then shut down and keep fracture close on this probant to provide this conductive bath. This is how it's executed, and this is the house screen on site. We start with bed without any probant, then start ramping probant with steps and or any other method, then shut down and keep the fracture closed and the fluid leak off in formation. So to understand how the fracture created in reservoir, this is a picture for the fracture. We introduce a frag with the bed, which create 90% of the fracture created in reservoir, and fill a part most of it with propane, with different concentrations, and keep the and then shorten and keep the fracture closed on propane, and leave information propane plus fracture fluid damage. For sure, no fracking fluid can degrade to zero residue. There is for sure some residue, and for sure is there a fracture fluid damage for kept in fracture. The previous picture is very simple, simplified by wing frack, but actually on well site it doesn't that's not absolute true. First of all, if there is a hard rock without any fracture, which is not happen in nature, it will be by wing planar frack. But in case of any fissures up in reservoir, these fissures opened during propagation of frack creating more complex effect. If there is more fissures like type C, multiple fracture grow together and compete with each other. If there is more fractures and more fissures, all of them open again with frack and create complex fracture network. So, but let us leave any simulator in hydraulic fracture doesn't work in with all these types. They just give approach for this complexity, but they work with simple planar fractures. So, like Dr. Gahi said before, it's frack is not always good. It's like a medicine. You can't take a drug without disease, without good diagnosis for your disease. If you took the wrong medical treatment, it will destroy your health and will affect your health. So, hydraulic fracturing need a good diagnosis for the fracture and for the reservoir and for what is the source of damage and what is the depth of neural bore damage, and is the problem of the well is tightness or neural bore damage, and should be clear to why we fracture, especially for the conventional reservoirs. For unconventional reservoirs, we frack all the well to start production. It's production. But for conventional reservoirs, we need to select the reason for hydraulic fracturing and design the hydraulic fracturing job with the best benefits to meet this diagnosis. We should keep in mind clear this concept. Hydraulic fracture is not a magic solution for all reservoirs. It's a specific solution for specific reasons in conventional reservoirs. One of the main concepts of hydraulic fracturing geometry is net pressure. Actually, hydraulic fracturing is to introduce net pressure in reservoir to create fracture geometry. And to this fracture geometry, we fill it with propant in probe diffract or acid with acid fracturing. So, to understand what is net pressure, we need to understand how this frack happened. We introduce information rate with our pumps on surface. We start pumping with rate higher than the matrix rate of the formation, and due to this high rate, resistance increase, which cause pressure increase, which cause the reservoir rock to break. So we pump with rate, we get response from formation with response from formation with pressure. So if we measure all, the only parameter we measure during pumping job is well head pressure. So if this well head pressure, if we added hydrostatic pressure to this well head pressure and substituted the pipe frictions, we will get the bottom hole pressure. It's very simple, equation. So this bottom hole pressure, which we measure from if we run hole with a bottom hole memory gauges. This bottom hole pressure in side wheel bore, if we substituted the entry friction, which is near wheel bore friction and the perforation friction, we will get pressure inside frac. This pressure inside frac has another resistance from formation, which is closure pressure or minimum horizontal stress pressure. So the net value which creates geometry is pressure inside frac minus closure pressure or minimum horizontal stress. To understand the entry friction which substituted from our pressures in perforation and around the neural bore, we can divide this entry friction to neural bore friction and perforation friction. Neural bore friction is due to what if we perforate a reservoir with different orientation perforation, but the fluid come out from casing through this perforation, but the frac propagate perpendicular to the least principal rock stress. This reorientation for the fluid make frictions which is increase our pressure at surface and decrease the net pressure in reservoir. Maybe this near wheel bore area has, and the tortuosity is very low and no problem during job, and in some other jobs due to there is a multiple bad perforation or multiple fractures and fissures around the rural bore or any other reason which may or any induced the drilling stresses during drilling operation, so this may increase this multiple tortuous this tortuosity frictions, and perforation friction is due to the friction due to this we have pumping through casing 5 inch or tubing 3.5 inch and come out 0.4, 0.38 diameter perforations. This cause frictions which increase the pressure on surface as it increase the response that we get from the oil. So these two frictions, perforation friction and neural bore friction and the pipe friction need to be calculated. Neural bore friction and perforation friction is calculated by step down test. It's a diagnostic test we'll talk about later. And by friction, we can calculate it from the rheology and the roughness of the well. It's simple equation to get the friction of frac fluid and in pipe. So net pressure is the net pressure that which create fracture geometry. So we need to understand what is the factors affecting net pressure. The only control point that affect net pressure, which during bumping hydraulic fracturing, is bumping rate and the bumping viscosity. It's like you create a fracture using hammer. Your hammer is viscosity, and your power to hit the the ground is bumping rate. So always keep in mind viscosity and bumping rate is the design parameter during the design job to control the net pressure created in formation. And there is another part of net pressure which called tip pressure. That's due to this unwetted fracture tip, which is not all the frac fluid reach the tip of formation. This fluid lag cause tip pressure and make the fracture formation property effect on net pressure, which called fracture toughness, which make this net pressure change from well to well. But it's not big value or big issue in hard formation. So most of net pressure created by viscous pressure or the viscous part of net pressure. So if we have a formation of sand formation and above, then there is difference between sand and barrier shale above and below this sand, we bump this and we bump hydraulic fracture in this sand. So how the formation the frac fluid create fracture in this situation. Multiple studies done on lab and on well site. We concluded one of the main concept of hydraulic fracture propagation, which is indicated in this picture. With this concept states when the net pressure in created in sand or the bay zone reach to 50% for the stress difference between minimum horizontal stress difference between the bay zone and the barrier above and below, it start propagation. If it reached to 70% of stress, this stress difference, it will propagate and will ruin the barrier when causing unconfined height propagation. Its main principle in which simulator every practical simulator till now use to simulate hydraulic fracturing, like frac brew or frac kit or any other simulator till now. So as we mentioned before, we create net pressure. This net pressure creates geometry. So what is how this net pressure translated to a geometry? Really, nobody knows actually how the fracture created created the bottom hole. Everyone take from its perspective take a part of and see a part of this hydraulic fracturing. Production engineer see the effect of hydraulic fracturing in production rate. Reservoir engineer care about the impact of cumulative production. Surface company engineer care about the impact of fracture geometry to place proppant or and fluid information. Geomechanics engineer need to know how fracture propagate information and the geomechanical the effect of geomechanical parameters. Geologic engineer and geologist see its effect with the natural fractures information and so on. There is a different perspective for hydraulic fracturing. So, or in the perfect design, we all of them should sit together and agree about the design to get maximum benefits from this design. We need to set a concept. This fracture modeling, it is not the real frac. The fracture modeling is approach for the fracture geometry. It's for sure it's more complicated in nature. For sure it's better, we get better eyes, we get better simulators every year with better resolution, but still there is need modification, and there's a concept, the concepts of fracture propagation develop year by year. Fracture modeling, the simplest mean for the fracture modeling is an integration between three main parameters: continuity principle, fluid flow principle, elasticity principles. The integration between these three principles make fracture model integrate some smaller models together to introduce a geometry for the fracture. So fracture model take net pressure from calculation that we saw before, and using the principle of continuity principle, flow principle, and the elasticity principle, it will integrate different propagations models, fluid flow and fracture initiation, rock deformation, fracture propagation, fluid loss, and proppant transport, and another minor models to introduce a best approach for fracture geometry in reservoir. The continuity principle, as simple as it is, we bump amount of fluid, which we have this fluid on surface. Then a part of it lost due to there is a permeability in reservoir, so we lost a part of it. Then we bump and the remaining volume create fracture from volume of from identification of the leak of volume, and we have the volume of fracturing fluid. We can get the volume of frac. Volume of frac can be integrated with the other two principles to get the fracture geometry. From continuity principle, we got the volume of frac. So volume of frac, it's translated to width and height and length. Fracture modeling started with a concept. This, we have a bay zone with barrier above and below this bay zone, and we set height constant in the first modeling for hydraulic fracturing. Then every model, two model introduced by Birkenkern and Nordgren and Gristima Declaric model, BKN and KGD. One of them introduced widths for the fracture propagation of the fracture to be a vertical ellipsoid, and the other introduced a fracture propagation, width created information as a horizontal ellipsoid. The first one is suitable for longer or narrow fractures, and the other KGD model is suitable for shorter or wide fractures, but both of them set height as a constant, as no propagation in their assumption, as in no propagation in barrier in their assumption, and introduce widths and solve to get lengths. So that is how fracture modeling started. Then, after these two models started, software started to develop by time to integrate these two models together, creating a new model called pseudo-3D model. The pseudo-3D model is just 2D with different types. Just to integrate KGD model with BKN model. Some of them integrated the two models as a cell-based model by dividing the volume of frac of to 10 cells and solve the three principles in as a cell by cell, and some create the fracture volume the fracture geometry as a lump based as a volume by whole, but as a one part, as a one cell, like FragBru model, the fracture geometry. By time, another, but pseudo-3D model have disadvantage. The flow behavior for the fluid is one dimensional. It from the wellbore to reservoir, no vertical flow modeling for pseudo-3D model. Pseudo-3D model used till now in operation in well site, and it's easy to use and suitable for practical fracture modeling, and it's very easy to use and suitable for field application. With time, we added a 2D fluid flow like in Gopher and stem plan model, creating a new model called planar 3D model. Planar 3D model just to add is to divide the reservoir to cells 2D and solve these cells, solve the three principles together to get the fracture geometry to get the fracture geometry with better approach than pseudo-3D model. With time and with development in simulation, full 3D model came to use like wire mesh model and unified fracture model. It's full 3D. It's like simulation to reservoir. It's provided in Betrel and. In kinetics shale with Schlumberger, it's dividing the reservoir to 3D cells and solves the equations with the main three principles which is continuity principle and elasticity principle and fluid flow principles to get the fracture geometry. But till now, it need a lot of data, need a lot of manpower. We need model need team to work for a month to create a model with good accuracy in this full 3D. Why we need to understand the propagation of hydraulic fracturing? That's why, we have a good understanding for how net pressure created in bottom in reservoir and what is the geometry created from this net pressure. During the start of bed, we start building net pressure and net pressure increase, so the vertical ellipsoid can represent our fracture geometry. Then with propagation and with different and with increasing leak off, so net pressure flatten with the mode 2 flatten and we can introduce the PKN as a representation for the fracture propagation. And if propagation of the fracture propagate in barrier, so best approach for this propagation will be KGD model. And from net pressure, we can know if our fracture accepting proband or doesn't accept proband from the net pressure also. This method is introduced by North Smith by drawing net pressure with time as a log scale. And from the slope of net pressure, we can translate how fracture propagate bottom hole. We can in mode 3 we can get the reason behind the screen out. We bump the job and we get screen out, and when we revise the net pressure, we get the reason if it's screen out due to the width in wellbore closed or the width in the tip in the fracture tip is not enough from identifying the slope of net pressure. So it's net pressure, it's very important concept needed to be observed and needed to be understood well during fracture design. As mentioned before, so 3D model it just approach to approach 2D for the integration for 2D the 2D 2D models KGD and BKN. One of the most disadvantage of pseudo 3D models is every formation parameters is averaged. So Young modulus, Boisson ratio, leak off factor, toughness, and all these parameters average in model as it use and get it, and it model with the best approach is just integration between the 2D models. Some in industry like right now we have FragBrew, which is lambda based model, and FragKid, which is cell based model. Like we talked before, lambda based pseudo 3D model is treats the frac as a same as a same as a one cell, as a one package, but the cell based model divide the fracture to 10 cells, when and each cell not coupled elastically with the other cell, so the, any deformation in this cell doesn't affect on fracture but on reservoir parameters of the next cells in beside it. So all parameters of reservoir in fracture propagation zone are averages, so it's still pseudo 3D model. Bladder 3D model, it divide reservoir as a cells, 2D cells, and apply fluid, and the fluid flow is now is two directional, direction from wellbore to reservoir, and the vertical direction, and which affect on the power of frac to create the geometry. Now there is no averaging for reservoir parameters. It is calculated cell by cell, so it get more accurate fracture geometry. For full 3D model, we divide reservoir to 3D cells and introduce frac to see with integration between the three main principles, the continuity principle, the elasticity principle, and the fluid flow principle, to get the fracture geometry. But it need a lot of data, it need a lot of manpower, it need not practical, it need a special machine for computers. It take time to model it, so it's not practical till now. Maybe in the near future it become practical. So this is comparison, quick comparison between the fracture modeling. So we need to each simulator have their own theory, their application and accuracy and the methodology we need to keep in mind during working on fracture simulator. Hadronic fracturing design. As said before, we need to identify what is the problem of our reservoir. Is it a damage or a permeability? Is it a low permeability or a damage? If we have a reservoir like with reservoir permeability, with roads like as a reservoir permeability, if we have a reservoir with a city like a city with its roads like a reservoir permeability, we need a long frac half length. If this roads in city are narrow to connect the maximum number of these roads to solve the problem of this of traffic in this city. If our city is wide street, so we have wide streets, so we have to bypass the restriction point with wide highways to solve the problem. So we need to balance between conductivity and the fracture length based on what is the parameter of reservoir. So we need to select between creating short wide frac by introducing very 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 fast ramping for propellant, or keeping large bed and with keeping propellant stages very very long to get maximum fracture length. at each type, we need based on the formation permeability. So how we design the fracture, the hydraulic fracturing based on reservoir permeability, it will be based, there is two methods to design our job. The first method is the based on the pseudo-steady state. If we have a well with production, with a certain production rate and certain productivity, PI, which is Q divided by drawdown, and we need to introduce a fracture to increase the fold of increase. There is a lot of optimization models and theories in literature, like UFD, Pratt, Economides, Mayer, tensely modified tensely, Prosper, Raymond, Binder, and Mayer, all a lot of models to introduce a fold of increase based on the fracture dimensionless fracture conductivity and fracture half length based on drainage radius to can be used to get the maximum the optimized volume for our job, to get the best suitable dimensionless productivity and suitable fracture half lengths. That is how design starts. We need to define the best dimensionless conductivity and the best fracture half lengths. From this two basic inputs, we need to introduce a bumping schedule based on local experience to get this XF and CFD and get production prediction from from this optimization charts and check with economical model. If it's economic, okay, we can proceed. If it's not economic, we can change the bumping schedule based on job volume and the amount of proppant, amount of fluid, and start again, introduce to the simulator with same reservoir parameters, another fracture design proposal, and get XF and CFD, and return to the optimization model to get prediction of the fracture, and check with economical model, and so on, and all this process controlled by local experience. Every frac engineer working in a certain area, he knows what is the effective XF and CFD for the formation he worked with. All fracture optimization models has no gain has a certain limit for the gain from fracture dimensionless fracture conductivity, and have also the effect, the gain from increasing fracture half lengths decrease with increasing the fracture half lengths. So we need to check with the economical model if this increase in job volume can be paid from the production or not. If we don't have a production history for a well due to any development plan or any other reason, we can design the job volume by creating an IPR model from nodal analysis, then conduct sensitivity for frac to get best fracture geometry, and introduce it with a design proposal in fracture simulator and get XF and CFD and check with economical model. If it's economic, okay, we can proceed it. If it's not economic, we return to reduce our dreams in IPR model and select another XF and CFD and get and so on and go to simulator to with another pumping schedule to get XF and CFD and so on until we get economic and with best approach for the enhancement of our IPR, so we can proceed with the job. So hydraulic fracturing design, what we need from this design, when we finish this design, is needed to know the number of pumps and all frac fleet capabilities, the number of, and we have blender, or we need blender or two blenders. What is the surface lines, two surface lines or to the well or four surface lines, all the frac fleet capabilities. We need to know what is the wellhead pressure rating, what is the tubing that we will use, what is the frac stack or frac head, 15K or 10K PSI for wellhead equipment, we need also to expect the execution. It's high pressure or low pressure. We need to minimize screen out possibility. We need to place a probant as optimized as we can. And we need to predict the production performance to justify this hydraulic fracture, and we need to optimize the cost. Every pound of probant and every gallon of frac fluid is a cost needed to be optimized to get paid after job by production of the well. Using simulator, we can expect the wellhead pressure and the required end rate, and from it we can inform surface company or frac fleet owner what is the needed horsepower for the job by this equation: is a pressure multiplied by pumping rate divided by 40.8 and with 50% as a backup horsepower. Let's start collecting data. So to start a fracture design, we need a lot of data. We need to sit in a round table with the petrophysicist, with the geoscientist, with the geologist, and geomechanical engineer, and we need to with surface company. All these disciplines need to sit together and to collect the data needed for hydraulic fracturing. We need open hole logs, logged in our reservoir. The drainage radius is very, very, very important, and the reservoir parameters to know what is the problem of the well, and the productivity index of before frac for the optimization model to get the fold of increase and like we talked before, we need to check with economical model from the fold of increase created by the frac. We need also a geomechanical model, a static horizontal Young's modulus boson ratio, minimum horizontal stress, tectonic strain, toughness. We also need the total compressibility, the rock compressibility, oil compressibility, gas compressibility, water compressibility in the reservoir, reservoir fluid viscosity, porosity, not net effective bay thickness. We need to identify our perforation interval, identify the tubing, the casing, the direction survey, and get data sheet of probant, get data sheet of frac fluid from surface company, get bottom hole structure map to see the distance to the fault and how the structure of this reservoir. General, any simulator work with this workflow. We need to define names, tubulars and casing data, tubing data, survey, all initial data. Then define reservoir parameter. Then define a fracturing fluid and define probant or acid, if there is acid frac simulator. Then assume bumping schedule. Assume this assumption bumping schedule, we can model it and get model results, which is dimension, conductivity and fracture half length. And if it doesn't fit our need from the fracture half length and the conductivity, return again may increase the viscosity of frac fluid to increase net pressure, to increase the fracture half length, or decrease the conductivity, decrease the viscosity, to decrease the gel residue, to increase the conductivity of the frac. We can increase the bumping rate, to increase wets, to increase the conductivity, and all this control points. We play with net pressure by viscosity and bump and the bumping rate by defining another bumping schedule, or changing probant, or changing fracturing fluid. Fracturing fluid is introduced in simulator by certain fixed data need to be imported from surface company, as it needs a lot of lab tests with the local source of water. We need to put in fracturing fluid the friction tables, rheology properties, a specific density. If we use different water than in library, then that's in library of simulator. We need to import the spirit loss and the whole building coefficient, and N prime and K prime for the frac fluid, and all these parameters. So we need to design this bumping schedule. What is the bed percentage, and what is the, how is the volume of each probant stages? We start with bed with 0 pound per gallon probant, then start with smaller probant concentration, 0.1, 0.5 or 1 pound per gallon probant to 1 pound per gallon of fracturing fluid, and start to increase the BBG concentration of probant till reach end of job, and shutting the bumps, and leave the fracture close. So treatment scheduling, we have some notes based on local experience and based on the fracturing fluid, fracturing propagation concepts. What is the bumping rate? for the our design. Mainly the main parameter which make us we don't pump with 90 barrel per minute in conventional reservoirs is a well tubular. We have casing 7 inch or 5 inch. We have tubing 3.5 tubing, which limit pumping rate to 36 barrel per minute. But for unconventional reservoir, it's different story. We drill the well to frack. So we drill 5 inch casing to withstand this high rates. But in conventional reservoirs, where the frack is a secondary operation for a certain reason. So bombing well tubular limit our bombing rate. We need to limit our dreams in local with for the bombing schedule with the local availability of equipment. We can for the early stages of probant, this the volume of these stages should be larger than the well bore volume to start. To see the interaction between probant and the reservoir in these early stages to understand how the fracture propagate and how the fracture propagate to minimize the problems. So the for at least two first stages like 1 BPG and 2 BPG. It need to be larger than well bore volume. We need to select between if we leave on over flush or under flush. Over flush, the flush volume or the volume we use to flush all the tubing and casing to perforation is there a need to insert all probant in well bore in formation, or there is under flush requirement, which due to the fracture pinch out in side well bore. There is a flow in literature. There is a flow efficiency based bombing schedule. A lot of equations based on the size of probant and the flow efficiency and the flow efficiency detected by the diagnostic bombing flow efficiency based flow efficiency test. And all, but it's theoretical. It can't be applied on well site. Probant stages it can be steps like this, start with 1 BPG and end with 1 BPG and start 2 BPG and end 2 BPG and so on, or ramping it to get higher conductivity to start 1 BPG to and increase gradually to 2 BPG move and to gradually to and to 3 BPG and so on. It's provide good, better conductivity. That's by experience. For some designer prefer if we have a bombing due to tubing 36 barrel per minute. Okay, let's bomb the job in 30 barrel per minute or 32 barrel per minute for and leave for the on-site frack engineer a room for possible increase bombing rate if he can. If there is some propant bridging in fracture, we need to increase bombing rate to wash this bridging and leave it to be on-fly decision. Bad percentage, it's around 35% of job volume. for Thebes Kirina to get short and wide frac, we decrease the percentage of bad percentage and get higher rate as we can, and ramp probant as fast as we can to get higher probant concentration at the end of fracturing. But nowadays it replaced with easy fracture technique or easy advanced fracture technique used called channel fracturing. It called with Schlumberger highway frac and called with Halliburton conductor frac. This is the channel fracturing. Channel fracturing mainly use the concept of the fracture permeability is larger than the intergranular permeability. So we bump probant as a pulses and leave channels between the pillars of and leave channels with between pillars to increase its conductivity. So we need also before selecting the treatment schedule, we need to select select the fluid or fracturing fluid. What's needed from fracturing fluid? First of all, it must be compatible with formation rock and fluid, and should be capable to create wets to start propagation of the frac and keep the fracture open to accept the probant. Can suspend probant from surface to deep to reservoir and deep into the fracture to place probant successfully, and should maintain viscosity during the treatment and break with clean and with least additives, with least residues after fracture close, and should be cost effective. It's economic based fracture fluid selection. There is in literature, there is a lot of workflows for the fracture fluid based for oil well and gas well, but local experience and the local availability control all this best practices for the frac fluid selection. For unconventional reservoirs, we introduce another reservoir parameter called brittleness index based on the Young's modulus and Boson ratio. We can select to treat the well with slick water or cross-linked frac fluid, as when the brittleness decrease, it will be more ductile and more probant concentration needed as it need to guarantee the fracture conductivity. So we need higher concentration using cross-linked gel. Cross-linked gel is needed in higher, if we need higher probant concentration. But in low reservoir and low permeability reservoir, like unconventional reservoir, where its permeability is nano-Darcy, so concentration of probant 3 pounds per gallon is very, very conductive, can provide conductivity better than this ranges of reservoir. So we need also slick water. It's enough for this reservoirs. But in conventional reservoirs, we use cross-linked gel. What's cross-linked gel? Frac fluid, simply in conventional reservoir, we have a water, that is the current used fluid. We use water and add guar, it's a powder we can get from India from it's planted in India and hydrated with water to get linear jelly. If we have a with it, it have it it get viscosity around 50 centiboles or around this number 50 60 centiboles. It's very very weak fluid. We add viscosity to this fluid by adding crosslinker. This crosslinker can connect long chains and for the polymers to increase the viscosity to give a capability to give to carry probant, then to carry especially carry probant especially for the high concentration. Then during the job we bump breaker. This breaker cut the connection between the long chains of polymer and get broken gel to be cleaned after frac. So the best frac fluid is who provide this capability to carry probant with high concentration and break with cleaner residue and leave the frac clear as we can. For probant selection, mainly the main parameter of probant selection is the stress. We need to in mechanical earth model calculation, we need to select based on the closure stress or the minimum horizontal stress the probant needed to be used in our frac to provide a good permeability relative to reservoir. As like if we have a, for example, a closure stress 6,000 psi. And we if we use sand, we will get permeability of this value. Maybe this sand is good for this reservoir, but this permeability value, which is this permeability value, if we multiply it by another well in another treatment, maybe not enough. So in this case, we need to increase the we don't use sand and use ISP. That is the reason why in unconventional reservoirs we use just only natural sand. It's, as an economical model, it's very cheap to use sand than and using coated sand. It's around half of its cost, but sand can provide permeability, which is better than every unconventional reservoir. So we don't get more attention to the conductivity of sand in this deep unconventional reservoirs. Also, we need to consider the permeability of the sand in fracture after frac fluid break and leave residue in fracture. Also, we need to put in consideration in for the future well performance when the reservoir fluid pressure depletes with production, then the closure stress increase, which is may cause crushing for the probant. So For proband selection, we need to look at with select based on closure stress, and should be note the and consider the fracture fluid damage and the fracture web performance. Maybe injection, maybe depletion on all this issue. Now we start to simplify the main workflow with FragPro. It's generally we talked with every simulator. We can now start with FragKit. We can now start with Stimplan. We can now start with the previous slides to start with any fracture simulator. Like we can start now with assembly with FragPro. FragPro, like we selected, we talked about earlier about the first window for any fracture fluid. Start well data. Just it's input data. Who is doing the design? Who is what's the comment, what is well name and field name and the location and formation name and the perforation details and all this admin information. For FragPro, we need to select the fracture analysis during the design, as we doesn't depend on we don't depend on FragPro to create a fracture treatment schedule. We put treatment schedule and see the results. So we need to select fracture analysis, and if we select fracture analysis and workflow will be appear on the left side, and we can go through forward and backward in FragPro with this buttons. First of all, we have three modes of fracture analysis in FragPro. It's job design and database and real time. Real time connected to FragVan and simulate what the net pressure coming from the van up to and update the fracture geometry during the job. Database data is if we have a previous job with net and previous pressure and rate and proband concentrations and all this issue, we need to simulate it in FragPro. We can import it through this smooth database data, but currently we select job design data. There's a lot of models in FragPro, but the main default model is a 3D shear decoupled model, which is lumped based pseudo 3 model with composite layering effect, which is enhanced propagation in Bay zone in more than non-Bay zone. Just pseudo 3D lumped based model, but just add based on papers, SPE papers, fracture propagation in Bay zone is more than in Bay zone more than non-Bay zone. If we try to database data, we need, if we have from data van, we have a CSV file or a file with parameters recorded from the job, select database data. We start normally data convert, which convert CSV file to DBS file or LAS file to DBS file. Just we need to assign each column in CSV file as we need to assign for a job. Like if we have a column treating pressure, we can in DBS file we assign surface pressure in tubing as a treating pressure, or the name of in the CSV, and the slurry flow rate to be the flow rate of pumping flow rate, and recognize the data and units in DBS file, and import it in FredPro. We have a lot of options, and models in for spatial treatments in FredPro, but it's a different story. A lot of time to talk about. After we define the basic of the modeling of that we will use, we start with defining the drilled hole. What is the depth, maximum depth of the hole, the of the well bore, and then we need to define the injection is tubing or through annulus, if we have a bucker or not. Our frac string will be full or partial full. If we use foam or frac fluid only, we need to define casing using weight and ID and grade and outer diameter. The only used number from this window, it used to know the well bore volume from the ID casing and tubing ID. It will get the volume of well bore. After that, we start to identify the surface lines and the tubing. If I have surface lines from the pumps to wellhead around 50 feet and 3-inch tubing, 3-inch tubing, 50 feet, 3-inch tubing, we define it, but we need to define it with minus as the bottom of our zero in fracture design, and especially in FredPro, our zero is wellhead. Before wellhead, it will be minus, and after wellhead, it will be positive to be included in our calculations. Every update, any update in tubing, perforation, casing will affect on fracture, frac string volume, and we can see 1D schematic view or 2D schematic view to see a sketch for a quick sketch for the tubing and perforation and the oil bore and all these parameters. For perforation, we need to identify the top of perforation and the bottom of perforation, and if we have a lot of perforation intervals, we need the top of perforation and the bottom of perforation, and multiply the number of perf for each interval and get some summation of for all this perforation, and put it in as a lump sum in number of perforation. And we need to check all perforation, tubing and surface line and casing is effect on both of frac fluid from the pumps to wellhead to tubing to casing to perforation to frac. So we need to confirm all this data is right, as we need to imagine we have a tubing. What is the depth of tubing end, and what is the casing from tubing to perforation? It's a casing area, and then perforation. We need, all this data should be integrated in mind and in and integrated in reservoir in simulator to be to use it in design simulation. Also, if we have a survey for your well, if we have build and turn and measure depths, if we have MD inclination azimuth, if we have north, south, east, west, and TVD, and or we have MD, TVD, and azimuth, we can copy and paste and put the inclination, put all data in survey, like from the data that you have from the directional survey for the well. Second model, we need to define the parameters of heat transfer model, which included in FragBrew. We need to define the temperature of surface temperature and bottom hole temperature, and confirm the reservoir frag. And is that really the measured depth for your frag or for your reservoir or not? If you can have another input data for the heat transfer coefficient multiplier or fracture heat transfer coefficient multiplier, you can change it based on core study or frac fluid study, special study for your wells. Okay, if not, leave it as standard. For then, after defining our well, we need to define our reservoir. Our reservoir in is defined with three approaches in FragBrew, based on lithology or based on multi-scale or general single scale. General single scale, it's average, it's averaged zones. We have in FragBrew 1,000 zone. Each zone have height, depths of its top and height. Yeah, we define like if we have a mechanical earth model with these values with this values for each 0.25 feet or 0.5 feet. It need to be averaged to get enough number of zones to simulate our frag. So of this averaging is needed to be used in the fracture modeling, in the log interpretation modeling, in the log interpretation software, to then before imported in FragBrew, as one of main disadvantage of FragBrew, by the way. We have it. So we need to select general single scale. We need to identify layers of reservoir with rock type and stress and Young's modulus, Poiseuille ratio, fracture toughness, and bore fluid permeability. We have bore fluid permeability to get leak-off coefficient, or if we have a core study and we have leak-off coefficient, we can select to enter leak-off coefficient directly in the model. if we have lithology based, and this is the best approach for the design through FragPro. If you don't have this data, you can depend on the lithology based by identification of lithology, and FragPro has a library for youngest modulus, Boisson ratio, and toughness for each type of this lithology, and identify parameters for the value of for this in for this model for modeling the job. If we have a multi-scale, if we need to divide or get zonation for zonation for the modeling of FRAG, different from zonation of stress difference, different from modeling of zonation of zone of mechanical earth model, or different from permeability and Ilikov coefficient, we can get multiple scales if we have this zonation from TICLUB or the software that you did mechanical earth model with. So if you need to define the Zipf parameter as a one general single scale, we can select general single scale and define with same height all this data, and get united zonation for all parameters. It's one of disadvantage of FragPro. We have only 1,000 feet, 1,000 zone. If we have a lot of details in our mechanical earth model, like this example, it will be averaged in a very average value, which is affect on accuracy of the model. This is to have a look to about the drug properties in library of FragPro. There is every rock type have a parameter for specific gravity and thermal parameters and a lot of data used in thermal modeling and in the minor modeling in FragPro. But let it leave default. Don't change it. And if you don't have different input in FRAG in due to study or any other issue, we need to identify. We identified rock properties. If we have another data, we need to identify the additional properties. It is a single layer. It's oil well or whatever it is. It's oil well or gas well. We need to identify the reservoir pore volume, so pore pressure, the porosity, to the compressibility, and all this data from reservoir, and insert the drainage area of reservoir, and get the depletion. If there is another a depletion, we need to identify the depletion as it will affect on proband selection and the proband permeability, which affect on fracture conductivity, like we see before. We have this rock properties. If we need to change library of FragPro, in our version of RegBrew, we can change it from Rock library and change database Rock properties saved in RegBrew. Then after we defined the reservoir, we need to redefine frac fluid and the propant. We have a lot of library needed to be identified and selected to be used in treatment schedule. If you can edit your current fluid, if all this standard fluid, fracturing fluid, mixed with 2% KCl water. But if we used 7% KCl water, 4% KCl water, and we did local lab data from surface company, you can enter it in FragBrew and edit current fluid and save or create user-defined fluid. Fluid should be identified with friction tables, like in the frac data sheet, frac fluid data sheet from surface company, friction tables, rheology properties, specific density, spurt loss, wall building coefficient, consistency index, and flow behavior index, which identify the behavior of viscosity of this fluid. All this fluid must be identified as close as we can to the your frac fluid on location. Probant selection, we have a lot of library, a lot of probant types and sizes and manufacturers in FragBrew. We can select our probant that we will use, if we use more than one type or one type only, we can select it and confirm its data with the data sheet of probant. And with surface company. One of parameters needed to be identified well in probant selection is probant damage factor. Probant damage factor is a decrease in probant permeability based on frac fluid damage. Halliburton, in most cases, about 0.5. If you have a regain permeability test using probant, we can add your probant damage factor. Some people put it 0.3. It's approaches based on your probant data and the frac fluid data. The best approach to conduct the frac and then conduct flowing and buildup and get the conductivity, and this conductivity matches with width of the frac and match conductivity of probant using this factor with the conductivity measured from pressure buildup well test analysis after frac. We need to identify also the bottom hole pressure, as this will affect in the future performance of the well, and for future performance for the conductivity of probant conductivity of probant for future performance of the well. Then we identify, so till now we identified our well, then identify our reservoir parameter, identified fluid and identified probant. Then we put a probant schedule. Probant schedule selected both stages, the volume of each stages. So if we have 60,000 gallon frac fluid, let's start with this number. So 60,000, 30% of bed percentage, we can start with 20,000 gallon. and 60 and 6 and the remaining volume would be probant. And each stage of this treatment schedule step is much larger than will bore volume, and we can select to start 1, 2, 3, 4 and step 1 BBG if we are confident and we are brave to be screened out without any fear. But if we have some fear from to get screen out, so let's start 0.5 BBG, 1 BBG, 2, 1.5 BBG, 2 BBG, and so on. But it will increase for sure the job volume and will decrease the end bottom, the end probant concentration. So it's up to you to based on your well and based on your target from frag. After after identify, we have we need to identify that slurry, and then flush should be. If you select it to work with under flush to not to make the frag close and get pinch out in wellbore and the frag, and the, if you have a frag and no connection with this frag using overflush, you select under flush. If you select under flush, you need to make main frag flush less than the wellbore volume. In this design, we selected flush with more than flush volume, so we choose to flush all propane in wellbore. We need to identify also in at minimum 2 hour shut-in period to get a fracture, a stabilized fracture conductivity from result from after simulation. We need, if you selected treatment totals, it will give you some statistics about your design or your bombing schedule. You select you the total probant number is 136 kilo bound. Bed percentage 31.5, and all this, and you used this material with this volume, and you used and it's just some statistics about your treatment schedule. Then you with simulation control, you get time step. It's best approach or best number to get time step if you have a conventional workflow to be 0.17 time step, and then 1.17 second time step and run simulator. If you need to see how fracture propagate, we can select view integrated fracture profile with logs and layers, and select what is the parameter that you need to show in your view. Then you can, if you run this from this button, you will see your treatment propagation in formation. If you put control and run the model, you can select the result to get the chart of job by selecting plot list from result, plot list, last open plot, and create your own plot list by just you. If you select job plot, it will be blank plot. If you click right click here, you will have blank table if you select any click left on any cell in this table. We will open another window to select what is the parameters that you need to show. Generally, we need to show surface pressure, the bottom hole pressure, surface proppant concentration, bottom hole proppant concentration, and the net pressure to see what is the result of what is the pressures of the job. So in just this case, we needed 25% pumping rate, and with pressures around 8,000 psi from pressure and this rate, we can select the required horsepower with 50 and add 50% as a backup, and tell surface company to bring frac fleet with this specification, this horsepower needed to be on location. If after seeing the results and finalize your result, you can generate report from section. We just generate report. It's very, very handy, and to create a report in FragBrew, we just select report, generate report, select what is the parameter needed, and we can select whole report and you can select and Excel report with these parameters. Just we need to add all parameters or just add all or remove all or add some essential parameters. We need surface pressure, we need fracture geometry results, all parameter you need to show in report, you can add it and generate and save it in Word file. This is the main FragBrew output parameter. It's fracture half length. This is the half length that fluid reached use during bed and all other proppant stages. Probed half length, it is the half length where is the proppant reached, and we can see the probed height, the height of frac which covered with proppant, and what is the top of frac and what is the bottom of frac, what is the maximum width, what is the average width, as there is a changing in width due to change in propagation of frac. All this parameter we can get in FragBrew and include it in report. For any report in FragBrew, is it the same for the fracture? If I give you any report in using FragBrew, how to ensure this is match the frac bottom hole? We need to, there is an important parameter needed to be matched using. If you see any report for in FragBrew, and is net pressure matching. Net pressure matching is just to ensure our model is the same information, the same fracture geometry information, by matching the net pressure from the model with the net pressure created in job. So if we have a net pressure match, so the result, this result is a good approach to the reservoir. But keep in mind, in net pressure matching should be matched also with another different source of your net pressure matched report. Good, should be matched with well test analysis results to ensure this fracture conductivity, fracture half lengths, and all this data should be matched with the production and the flowing buildup, with test analysis. There is a different approaches for net pressure matching for each fracture simulator. This is a FRAGBRU net pressure matching strategy. We start matching the anchor points and the deviation, the deviation for leak off and during bombing, by changing these parameters and run again the model to get the best approach for the fracture modeling. It's art, which is I can get match with changing some parameters, and you can get match with different parameters, and one another one get match with different parameters. The most realistic one is if I change the permeability and we have an accurate permeability before frac, it's wrong. So we need to match with a logic values which integrated with another source of data. Another workflow from another workflow for fracture simulator is with Gopher. We can go through quickly a simplified main workflow. We can, if we open installed Gopher and started with Gopher, we can create a new project or open existing project. Also, we have a backward or forward through workflow. If you need to work on existing project, we can select it and proceed with your project. If you need to create new Gopher project, it's also or admin data. Gopher has two different concepts: treatment oil and different inference oil. Gopher mainly started with unconventional reservoirs. So we have a reference well to create mechanical earth model and apply it with and take the model from reference well to the treatment well and apply frac on treatment well. So treatment well is the well where we apply frac. Reference well, when we integrate if you integrate the mechanical earth model with the treatment tool. This is the main workflow. It's easy workflow with Gopher. We start with information, and project setting is Gopher has a model to integrate log analysis and to get mechanical earth model and with the fracture modeling. So we need to identify overburden gradient and if it's groundwater, if it's offshore, we need to add seawater and depths and seawater gradient. It's the main parameter for project to be applied for all the projects. We need to identify the location. If you have a reference well and treatment well, we need to identify location for each well. Then copy and paste the survey for the direction survey for the well, MD inclination azimuth and MD or MD TVD based on what you have in well data. And will display the trajectory of the well in the right. You can import open hole logs. If you have a gamma ray, you can import it and create mechanical ERSA model. Correlation is just based on correlation. Or if you have monopole sonic log, it can work with it. If you have dipole sonic log, you can work with only with this data. If you have a better physical interpretation or triple combo log, if you can, any types of log, you can import it. If you have a mechanical earth model, which is you created using another software, you can import it like here, like if you just click, right click here in treatment less, add less CSV, import the actual data, and put the parameters in the top of Gopher curves and bring it to top and make it the property to be to take it in consideration, like this our SHN created by another software, and the offset, and if there is offset for the stress, if we need to identify Boswell ratio, okay, just drop the Boswell ratio in Boswell ratio curve, and all this any other parameter, if you have your cutoffs in petrophysical analysis, and you need to consider the in Gopher, you can drop it in Gopher interpretation parameters, and it's very easy to be included in Gopher. For sure, no zonation in Gopher. It's HSL, has its value. So if you have log 0.5, every 0.5 feet or 1 feet or 0.25 feet, it will be a good, you can work with it directly without zonation. You can then, if you had open hole logs like gamma rays, triple combo log, any logs need to be converted to mechanical earth model or interpretation to get interpretation of mechanical earth model, you can import it with right click in source curves and import log. So, and you need to identify the calibration of the tool, if it's what it's calibrated to detect sand or carbonate, and get grain density for what you calibrated tool with. So in Gopher, we have three types of curves, reference curves to adjust the gamma ray and the caliber to know when during the interpretation to know roughly what is your zone, and there is a model curve which is copy or average or summation or any other from the used curves, induced curves, and if there is a curve needed to be omitted from your it's unlogic or doesn't fit another source of data, you can omit it to move the curve to the omitted curves. It's very useful. It's very easy to use log assistant and to generate mechanical earth model in Gopher. After we create a mechanical earth model, we can distribute it. You can create a geological section. Every geologic section have a grid setup, design, and diagnostic. Grid setup is a jurisdiction is that's your job, that's your design. Grid setup, it's your reservoir. Your job design is it's your treatment schedule and your pumping job and your pumping schedule. And diagnostics needed if you have a diagnostic pumping like fluid efficiency test, many step down test, defect, we need to interpret all the data from this diagnostics, we can diagnostic within this geologic section. So we need in after you select geologic section, now we start the design in your this reservoir. You need to identify wellbore settings, wellbore fluid, all reservoir parameters. It's as when you don't have any of this data, just leave it default, but or auto calculate. But if you have data, it will get much closer approach for your model to the actual fracture having information. So set grid setup. So if we select geologic section, then and put general reservoir parameters and well parameters and well string and well bore fluid, you select grid setup. Grid setup should be selected to contain the fracture. If we have your frac is expected to be larger frac, you need to increase the number of columns. Node size is the number, the size of the size of the node of calculation. Aspect ratio is the node length regarding to its height. So we need to get height and aspect ratio to get the size of the node. You need to assign grid top to be 3,000 feet, 300 feet above your base zone, and grid bottom 300 feet below zone. It's a reasonable number to contain the frac. If you have grid to be from surface of the well to the bottom hole of the well, it will be large number of grids which need time to in simulation. So minimize it for better visualization for and better simulation. After you put this value of grid setup, if you click next, and it will distribute all log data in reservoir horizontally, and that's what you have as data wise. You can see stress total and all these parameters used in buffer modeling. It's pore pressure, Bozor ratio, Young's modulus, stress on permeability, and all this data need to be up double checked during grid setup. Then after grid setup, we like frac pro, we identify reservoir, we then identify a pumping schedule. In geologic section, create job design, and it will start job design with create sub branch and with design one, name it as whatever you want, define perforation, bombing schedule, and then run engine. Perforation, you can simulate different different interval if you have top interval and bottom, and add another cells and the bottom perforation, top perforation, bottom perforation, perf diameter, perf shots, number of perforation shots in this interval, then return to the bumping schedule. If you click bumping schedule, this window will appear to you. It based on also if you have an old job, you will old job, you can import it through actual boss job. If you have a frag van and you need to simulate the current job, it will be real time. If we have a design, so we can select design schedule to put a schedule for the design. This is design schedule, just same parameters like frag room, define fluid, define probant, define probant, style probant concentration, and probant type. This is a different libraries from different companies included in Gopher. If you have your probant or your sand, you get same data. You get data sheet to get to define it as a user defined probant, and it's possible in Gopher. You get proper slide rate for each design, for each design stage, then return to the design and run engine. Gopher is very good simulator, which give a lot of data and give most accurate data expectation for simulation till now with available data. Then if after simulation ends, we can get the results to see if the bottom hole pressures, the wellhead pressure, the what is the frictions, and all these parameters. Then we can, if we select grid type, it will get a lot of data in as a grid distribution for the fracture widths, for the fracture pressures, for the net pressure, for the baseline conductivity and the injection rates, and all this. We can also see the how fracture propagate by running this gray button to see how the fracture propagate and what is the stage of each fracture propagation. We can play with all this data, and get back and forth to see how the fracture propagate using Gopher. If you return it to design window, you can get the results of Gopher. So we can get the gross frac length is the maximum length of frac fluid, which can get into formation. We have maximum fracture widths, average fracture widths, average probant concentration, and all this data. And for sure, Gopher has his own fork flow for the net pressure matching using very different parameter than FragBro. It's a very, very long story. It's very, very complicated process. Just simple overview. Just open your version of Gopher or FragBro, define a schedule, and get the results, and play with the treatment schedule and get results. And by try and error, we can get we can learn a lot of lessons from your designs. So we need to remember is frag is not a magic for the war. It's just a cure, just a medical treatment to which should be related to a well-defined diagnosis. Local experience with offset well experience is very useful. So the first design in your area, for sure, will learn you a lot. Integrated workflow is a must. We need to sit together with everyone related to our reservoir. We need to know if you have any design, it's not optimized without permeability and drainage area. We need to balance during the design between successful job placement and post-fracture production. So it's a local area, local experience rules, and there is a continuous improving process, and well by well, you learn another lesson which modify the next design. Thank you. If you have any question, you can ask me, Dr. Gahi.
Thank you very much, Engineer Mohammed Gabri, for the very informative presentation about frac simulation. We will post this video on YouTube and Facebook, and we will ask students to write questions. And for sure, we will be happy to invite you for a second session, Q&A session, to answer these questions. So thank you very much for that presentation. And have a wonderful day or evening.